rise. You may be seated. Dying, Christ destroyed our deaths, and in rising, Christ restored our lives. Christ will come again. And as in glory, Christ put on the glory of God, so today Bob is clothed in the glory of God because he is with Jesus and with God in heaven. And here now, dear friends, we are all God's children, and what we shall be has not yet been revealed to us. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. Jesus shared words for us on days like this, words that were meant to comfort us, and I share those with you now. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and I am the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet they shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I'm alive forevermore, and I hold the keys to hell and death." And this is my favorite part: "Because I live, you shall live also." Dear friends, we are gathered here today to bear witness to our faith, to celebrate and worship God, and to bear witness to the life of Robert Vandiver, the life that he shared with us, God shared with him, and he so richly shared it with us. As I spoke with people around town and through church and his family, the thing that just kept coming around over and over again was just what a wonderful man he was and how he shared the life that he had been given, and he lived it to its fullest and shared it with you all. So we're thankful that you're here today. The family thanks you for coming. I thank you for coming. And as we celebrate his life today, I thank you as you participate and as we honor him today. Now, friends, we know that God may grant us that in time like this that it's hard. And we want to, sometimes people say things like he's in a better place, and that is true, but it doesn't make it any easier, does it? So we come together today, and part of what we're doing is acknowledging our grief. And so it's okay to cry, and it's okay to laugh, and it's okay to feel whatever you feel today, because I know that God, in our sorrow, he will give us strength. In our pain, he will give us comfort. And that ultimately in our deaths, we will find resurrection.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Was great. grace than when we first begun. Than when we first begun. Let
us pray. O God, you gave life and birth to us, and we know that you are often more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask, and even our ignorance in asking. And yet we come before you today, that as we shrink before the mystery of death, asking that somehow you might show us the true joy of life. We thank you today, Father, for all those who've gone before us and who now rest from their labors. And we ask that today, that as Bob stands with you, that he may rest from his labors, that we, his friends and his family, may be assured of his eternal salvation, and that we may live our lives in the great joy of having known him. We thank you for him. And everyone who we name in our hearts today who have gone on before us. And we ask that you offer, Father, a blessing upon his family and on his friends, that they may know his love, that you may continue to show his love in them and through the Holy Spirit, and that through it all, Father, that we might be made whole when we are broken. And that as we come today, as those who are hurting, that you might give us strength to continue, and that you might give us the inspiration of Bob's life as an example of how we ought to live our life. We ask you for all this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I offer to you this morning one of the Psalms. It's Psalm 23. It's familiar to most of you, I'm sure. But I ask you this morning to hear it in a different way. Sometimes when you hear things read over and over again, you think you know what they say, and you stop listening. So I want you to listen this morning to the 23rd Psalm. Don't think you know what it says, but actually hear the comforting words that God has for us in this time. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I'm going to invite one of Bob's granddaughters, Lindsay Vandiver, to come this morning and share about her grandfather.
Thank you all for coming. My name is Lindsay Vandiver, and I feel so honored to have the opportunity to convey even a fraction of what my papaw meant to me and the impact he had on my life. I hope that I am able to do him justice. My papaw was adored by everyone who knew him. Over the last few days, I've tried to pinpoint what exactly it is that made him so special. I imagine the answer is different depending on who you ask, but what it came down to for me was how present he was. As a grandfather, I never felt like there was somewhere he'd rather be. From the days we spent playing school in his office, to all the time we spent walking around Crossett, going to the playground, the trips to the mall and the bookstore to shop for Christmas gifts, I never felt like he wanted to be anywhere else. He never was disinterested in what we had to say or anything. It's hard to grasp how rare this is until you know that it's gone. He was the smartest, most hard-working man I ever knew, and he would never pass up the opportunity to play at the playground, to watch a fashion show or a dance party. He always showed up for us, even when it required 8-hour car rides, and that became increasingly hard on him as he got older. Losing a person like this is an enormous loss, and it devastates me that he won't get to see my brother Bobby or cousin Will graduate high school, or that he won't get to see my sister get married. These are all things he wouldn't miss for anything. And it feels really unfair. My papa was a thoughtful man in all aspects of his life. There was never a neighborhood walk or a Walmart run that didn't involve him addressing people by name. And I knew that he carried this into his professional life and everything. He remembered people's families and paid attention when he asked them how they were doing. I watched him prepare for his Sunday school classes, going over readings and verses, always making sure he knew everything he needed to say. When we would visit, there would always be snacks that he knew that we loved. I'll miss him in the littlest of moments. His insistence that he didn't like French fries, despite the fact that he never turned them down. Conversations about every little thing. He was the best person I ever knew. I'll miss knowing that I always had him in my corner. He devoted his whole life in service to others. He was honest, diligent, and faithful. He served the church and the food bank until his body gave in, and he served his family until he died. I feel great relief knowing that he has assumed his rightful place in heaven, free of illness and injury. He deserves nothing short of eternal life, free from any pain and suffering. It's hard to imagine a life without him to all of us who loved him, but I know that his memory lives on in all of us, and I see all the best things about him in my cousins, my siblings, my uncle, and my dad. It's comforting knowing that I don't have to look very far to see him. I can't wait until I can see him again.
Thank you, Lindsay. I don't know what else I'm supposed to say about a man after his grandchild tells you that. I mean, anything I'm going to say will pale in comparison. So thank you, Lindsay. And it's, I don't know how hard that is to do. Maybe some of you do, but I appreciate you fighting through and being there for your grandfather. It's my job to try to help us see, one of the things I believe with all my heart is that we're all made in the image of God. And we all kind of reflect a different part of the image of God. If we were all the same, then we wouldn't see the wholeness of God. And so it's my job to help us see the part of the reflection of God that Bob reflected in our lives. And it's not hard at all. The words, as I spent time with the family, that came to mind to them were the word that just kind of kept hearing beating me over the head was this word, faithful. And I think if you knew him, he was faithful to whatever he did. And to me, somebody who's faithful is somebody who does what they say they're going to do. They're where they're going to say they're going to be. They're the first one there and the last one gone when there's work to be done. They're present with their grandchildren. They do what people need. They do what they say. And that's the kind of man Bob was. And honestly, one of the things that I've only been here about a year, and so I've known Bob for about a year, and one of the things that seems really odd is that he should be sitting in the balcony. And he always loved to sit in the balcony, and I knew that it was getting hard for him when he would come to church and he would agree to sit down here. So if I thought we could get all y'all on the balcony, we probably would have made you all sit in the balcony for this today. But there's something to be said about having a place, isn't there? He knew his place, and he was in his place. And his place here in this church was in that balcony, but it was also in doing so many other things. And so as I thought about this idea that he was faithful, I took my Bible out and I began to look for verses that spoke to faithfulness. And it didn't take long before I ran across a book that I didn't expect to find it. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 32, verses 3-5, I found this. It says, "For I will proclaim the name of the Lord, ascribe greatness to God, the rock. His work is perfect, and in all his ways are just, a faithful God, without deceit, just, upright is he." Now, I don't I don't want in any way to try to tell you that Bob Vandiver was like God in its totality, because none of us are. And Bob had his faults, I'm sure, although I haven't heard any of them from anybody I've talked to. But I'm sure he made mistakes, and I'm sure he came up short. But man, if I think about a God who's faithful, and then that word when I read it in Deuteronomy, the rock. The man was a rock for his family. He was a rock for that meal. He was a rock for Crossett. He was a rock for our church. And he was, when I think about steadfast, true, having integrity, all the things that a rock symbolizes, unmovable, just a man of who, just kind, did what he said. I was moved to tears by what Lindsay had to say. He was present. I didn't think about that. That's a wonderful way to say it. And I want to tell you something, people. There's nothing. One of the things that we try to do for each other is sometimes we try to say the right words. Sometimes we try to do the right things. Some of the most important things we can do in life is to simply be present for people. Show up. And Bob always showed up, didn't he? Whether it was for a birth, or whether it was for, like you said, a walk in the park, or the many other stories that that are told about him as a family man. I immediately identified with him, because one of the things that they said about him is that when they would bring their friends over, that he would immediately just accept their friends, and they were family too. He had a way of extending family and at the same time caring for family so deeply. He didn't want to spend his money. You might call him tight. But I think most people, his kids, and they understand the reason. And I get this, because I had a mother-in-law who was this way. He wanted to keep his money so that he could leave a legacy for the people behind him. And I was going to get on to him a little bit. And sometimes you got to do that. Sometimes I was going to point out maybe one of his flaws. And I thought that one of his flaws was that he never spent any money on himself. And that he just – it does your kids good to see you go on trips. It does your grandchildren good to see you spend some money on yourself. And I thought he hadn't spent any, but I did find out that he did actually get the Corvette that he'd wanted his whole life. And so, but for the longest time he wouldn't, but I think his kids hounded him enough that he finally did something for himself. But he was a rock for a family in a way that he was there for them. Unconditional love, you could hear it in the stories that the family tells, that he never stopped loving them because of something they did or something they changed. And what I loved, as they told, and you could almost hear envy in some of the family's voice when they said he had a way of loving that got ramped up with each new generation. He loved his children, but he loved his grandkids a little more, and he loved his great grandkids a little more. And I imagine the next generation, he had a way, and that's crazy, because so many of us, we have this idea that when you divide something or you spread, that it gets less, but somehow for him, it got to be more. Oh, and you know what surprises me? That this could be a man who's known for his work. He's a man, and a lot of men who are known for their work are not present at home. They get caught up in the work, and that becomes their whole life. And then somehow this man was able to have a work life that was his whole life, and at the same time still be at home for his family. They tell stories of him coming home from working at the mill and having to mow the yard. And this get-up that he would put on to mow the yard, these orange shorts and black socks. And I recently caught myself wearing athletic shorts and colored socks, and I thought, oh, Lord, we're getting old now. But Bob would get out there in this get-up, and they would make fun of him. And he'd say, he'd flex and say, I'm Fabio. But what did y'all – they said, no, you're Flabio. Is it Flabio? And so they called him that even till recently. And matter of fact, I think Maddie said, that's the only thing I knew to call him for the longest time. So although he was a very serious man in a lot of ways, he's also a very funny man, and he knew how to laugh. I used to get the sense that he knew how to be wherever he was. When it was time to be serious and work hard, he was serious and he worked hard. When it was time to laugh and to carry on, he knew how to laugh and carry on. They tell the story about y'all have to give me a little bit of a break, because there's so many Roberts, Bobs, and Bobbies, and that I get them confused sometimes. But I believe this is Robert IV Bobby. Do you go by Bobby? you go by Bobby or the fifth, and he was looking in the hose for some reason, and Bob had the other end clamped over here and was watching him, and he would open it up and it would hit him in the face, and then he would go back for more and he'd hit him again. Once wasn't good enough, so he was the kind of guy who knew how to mess with people, and those are the most fun people, aren't they? He didn't take life, he took things that he needed to very seriously, but he didn't take all of life too serious. And that's something we could all learn, isn't it? That it's okay to work hard. It's okay to be the best at what you do, but it's also important to come home and to be present and to love your family. Listen, a lot of grandpas, a lot of fathers are grumpy when other kids come over. They're like, get them kids out. I can imagine they didn't hold them as family. Seems like he just the more the merrier, and he just loved them all and cared for them all just like they were family. And boy, do you see the image of God being reflected here? The unconditional love, the adoption. You know, we're adopted as children of God. He adopted everyone as family. You want to make God laugh? You ever tell him your plans? God has a sense of humor, I promise you. I've seen it lived out in my life, just like Bob. And God is always present, no matter how far away he might feel, no matter how distant you might have pushed him away, no matter how far you may have run, God's still there. And I get the sense that you couldn't do much to make Bob stop loving you. You couldn't do much to make Bob be angry at you. That I imagine slow to anger, slow to talk, quick to think, quick to listen, all those kinds of things. He was a rock for his family. He was a rock in such a way that even working unbelievable hours at the mill, as a single father later on, he even cooked meals for them, cared for them. William or Billy, nobody has their real name. Everybody goes by a name other than, so. But Billy says he wanted a dog. And after his mother and father separated, I think he might have used that as a little bit of leverage to try to get a dog. And anyways, long story short, Bob wasn't going to get him a dog, but Bob gave in and went and got him a dog, kind of on the down low. And the funny part of that is they would come in when they weren't there and find that dog in Bob's lap being held. And when he wouldn't cook for them that night, he had cooked the dog a hamburger for itself. So he didn't just love his grandchildren, he loved his granddogs. I mean, it seemed like wherever he was or whatever, he had a sense of a way to fit in. He had a sense of being present. I love that. I wish I'd have thought of that word, present. Let me tell you something, folks. When your friends are in the hospital and you think you got to know exactly what to say, all you got to do is show up. You don't have to know what to say. Today, when you want to come here and you want to say the right things to the family, you don't have to say it, just be here. And Bob showed us that in the way that he was a rock for his family because he showed up. He was present. And part of all the things that we can say good about him, all go back to that. That he was there, he listened, he cared, he didn't want to be anywhere else, and he heard you. He was also a rock for the mill, wasn't he? He started as an hourly worker. He worked his way up little by little till in the end he was the part of the man. I don't understand everything out there, but a big portion of it he was the manager over. And then he became a consultant nationwide, became an expert in that part of the world. From, you know, so many people who are hourly workers, you know what happens? They put in just enough time to get their money and to go home, because when the clock strikes five, they go home and they leave it. But Bob wasn't like that, was he? He gave everything. He was present even at the meal. And you know what he said? And I love this. He said, that old adage, he said, I never worked a day in my life, because he loved what he did. When nobody else wanted to climb in the dryer, when none of the other bosses did, he did. He never asked anybody to do anything that he wasn't willing to do himself. The rules applied to everyone the same. Even the big wigs, when they would come in, they had just instituted a new rule where you had to have steel-toed shoes in the machine room where he was the manager. And this big wig tried to come through there without steel-toed shoes on, and he wouldn't let him. And he wouldn't back down. Because Bob was a man of integrity. He said, if it mattered and it was right for me to do it, then it's right for you to do it. I mean, they just don't make them like that anymore, do they? I mean, I know there had to be more flaws than I've heard about, but there can't be many, because I don't know what they would be. The man was a rock. He stood for people. He was there for people. He was there for his church, his meal. When we talk about things that happen at my present trustee chairman, every time we talk about something, when he'll say, well, Bob did this when we did it that way, and Bob did this, and Bob did that. And in fact, the family found a notebook of detailed, line-by-line documentation of everything he ever did for the church and who he talked to and how they did it and how they answered it. Bob cared deeply. He taught Sunday school. And even in these last days when it was hard, he was at this church every time the doors were open if he could possibly be here, usually sitting up in that balcony in his spot. That's where he belonged, and he showed up and he was there. He belonged in his family's house, and he showed up and he was there. He belonged in his grandkids' lives, and he showed up and he was there. I mean, I wish I could say, I can't say that about my grandpa, that I ever thought he didn't want to be somewhere different. He kind of always seemed like he wanted to be somewhere different. I hope you understand how rare it is. I mean, how beautiful of a man he was, and how wonderfully lucky and blessed you are to have him as your grandfather, as your father, as your fellow church member, as a community member, as a coworker, as a boss. I mean, most bosses don't escape with the best of words, you know, because when you're a boss, you got to do things that people don't like. Yet somehow he had a way of demanding hard work out of people, and at the same time them admiring him for it, them always appreciating him, saying he was the best boss they ever had. When I told the family, I said, one of the things that happens when somebody passes away, they become either a saint or they became the worst person that ever was. And when they started telling me all these good things, like, don't we have anything bad to say? And the truth is that the worst thing we could probably say about him, that he was tight. And that wasn't even because he wanted it for himself. It's because he was saving it for somebody else. So all this is a beautiful way to honor Bob and to think about him. But I'm thankful you're here today, and you came today to honor him, and I appreciate that. But one of the things I try to always remind us is that if you really want to honor Bob, if you really want to keep his memory alive, you don't do that by coming here. You do that by going out there and living a little bit differently because you knew him. Because somehow the image of God reflected off of him into your life, and maybe you had a little more integrity because of his integrity. Maybe you were a little more present, or you will be more present because you've heard the testimony of how that presence makes a difference in a young girl's life and in a family's life. Maybe you work harder. Maybe you learn to make work not work at all, but a joy. Maybe you learn to laugh better. I don't know what it is, but whatever Bob did in your life, however he changed your life, however he made it different, I want to challenge you today to be a little bit better person, because the image of God that he reflected onto your life has made you different. That's how we honor him. So again, thank you for coming today. But I want to challenge you to live differently because you've known Bob. And not because Bob is to be emulated, but the image of God in Bob is to be emulated. And though he was not perfect, gosh, he was a pretty good, darn good man, wasn't he? So be a rock for the people that need you. Be there for your grandkids. Show them how much they matter. Be there for the grand dog. If the dog is at home and needs somebody to cook it a hamburger, cook your grand dog a hamburger. There's something about a heart that's willing to love something that he never wanted a dog in the house ever. And yet love has a way of changing us, doesn't it? His love for his son who wanted a dog that came into his life that he didn't want, but yet he opened up and loved and took in. Grandkids, friends of grandkids, all those people who've come through his life, the many of hundreds of people that he met at the meal, the people that he went all over the United States consulting about things that he knew and sharing his knowledge. Every time he would retire, they would drag him to go somewhere else, or somebody would need, even competitors of GP would call him and ask for help. And he you know, I imagine if his health could do it, he'd probably still be doing that to this day. So we come today, and I'm thankful that the lessons that Bob teaches us are lessons that we can all learn, and they're all things that we can grow from. What a great man, what a great legacy, what a wonderful family he leaves behind. And I'd encourage the family to especially you all, to live the life that he has inspired you to live, because he's left you a legacy, not just of financial things, but of integrity, of what it means to work hard, what it means to love, what it means to be present, and what it means to reflect the image of God for the people around you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, may we honor God today, may we honor Bob today, and may we be better people because of both of them.
How great thou art.
Robert Lester Vandiver III, age 80, and resident of Crossett, Arkansas, passed away on Sunday, February the 20th of 2022. He was born in Little Rock, Arkansas, to his parents Robert Lester Vandiver II and Lola Moses Vandiver on December the 12th of 1941. He was a member and trustee of the First United Methodist Church and volunteered at the local food pantry for many years. He worked for over 45 years at Georgia Pacific as a plant manager and serving as a consultant in the last few years of those years. Bob had a heart of gold and loved making his family laugh. He enjoyed his work and volunteering, but more importantly, his family, especially his grandchildren and great-grandchildren, who he was so proud of and became his purpose in life. He is preceded in death by his parents and one brother-in-law, Robert Hayden. He is survived by two sons, Robert Vandiver IV of Marietta, Georgia, and William Vandiver and Lisa of Crossett, Arkansas. Six grandchildren, Lindsay Vandiver and Trevor Devine of Peachtree Corners, Georgia, Lauren Vandiver of Ackworth, Georgia, Robert Vandiver V of Kennesaw, Georgia, Madeline Cockerham of Crossett, Arkansas, Leah Haygood and Donald of Arkansas, of Crossett, Arkansas, William Vandiver of Crossett, Arkansas, two great-grandchildren, Andy Cockerham and Everett Haygood, three sisters, Carol Hayden of Little Rock, Arkansas, Linda Owens and Dwight of Indianapolis, Indiana, and Susan Young of Little Rock, along with a host of nieces and nephews, and I might add, tons of friends and co-workers.
Let us pray. God, of all of us, your love never ends. When all else fails, you are still God. We pray to you for one another in our time of need, and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give your light. To those who are weak, give your strength. To those who have sinned, show your mercy. And to all who sorrow, grant your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. And receive into your arms, Bob, into your mercy, and raise Bob up with all your people. Receive us also and raise us up into newness of life, and help us so to love and serve in this world that we may enter into the world to come with joy into your arms. Now may the God of grace and peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of his eternal covenant, made you complete in every good thing, so that you may do his will, working among us that which is pleasing in the sight of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thy faithfulness, morning.